Welcome to the Science Jerks. I'm your host, Dave Chacho. With me, as usual and always, Robert Chan.
Hi.
And we are back with the start of a brand new week and a brand new guest. Joining us for the first time is a writer,
you
comedy
say that
writer.
Like that's not a thing. We haven't ever had a repeat guest. Everybody
well,
has
today
only
is no
been
different. Instead of all those other times when the exact same thing happened, this time the exact same thing is going to happen even more. As we welcome Jeremy Bellinger, comedy writer, performer. Welcome, Jeremy.
Thank you, guys. I'm super stoked to be here.
I can tell.
That sounded insincere as fuck.
It is.
I did.
You are a good performer.
Thank you.
So what do you do?
I am a writer-performer, kind of. I have a sketch team called The Mutiny at IO West.
And do you write and you perform?
I write and perform.
Then why would you say that it was kind of? That's what you do. You do it at a reputable theater in the heart of Hollywood.
It's modesty, Chan. Learn a little bit.
Oh, I see. Yes. Well, you know, I just throw off a few things.
Humbly.
Have you heard of Bill Shakespeare? A couple poems here and there. It's no big.
You wrote Shakespeare?
Yeah, I wrote Shakespeare. But it was just his name on a napkin last night.
But okay, it was well written.
It was well written.
And you performed the shit out of it. Shakespeare.
You are kind of a writer.
As long as you do it in Hollywood,
that you
counts.
Know how to write yes. letters and words.
Yeah. Same thing as a third grade student.
Do you do online-y type stuff, videos,
yeah.
Twitterings?
Yeah, I have a few video. I have a YouTube channel that I do stuff on occasionally,
Ooh,
which
so
is
people
fun.
People who are in Papua New Guinea can see you. They can see what you look like.
Yeah.
Match a name to a face.
So I did like a parody of a video called The Raid Redemption, which is like one of the best action movies. Released last year.
I just saw it like last week.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Love it.
It was amazing.
Yeah, I've been hearing good things about that.
Yeah, but the funny thing is that like it's a Filipino movie, so I put out this parody kind of video about it, and I looked at like the because I kind of really nerd out about the AdSense stuff on your YouTube channels, and like 90% of the views for that video, it got like 2,000 views, were from the Philippines. So like so I have like a bunch of views in the Philippines now.
Did you have
not
any
a bunch, but more
comments
than...
in other alphabets? Like
one guy was like, I said like I basically did like a fake audition. He's like, well, come to Jakarta. And I was like, I'm not going to.
Also, that's Indonesia.
I know.
Are you sure
it's an Indonesian movie. It wasn't Filipino. That's what it was.
Anytime someone on the internet, and this is a good rule of thumb for everyone out there, if someone asks you to come to Indonesia and they're on the internet,
no,
don't do it.
They're not known to you personally. Even if they are known to you personally, just don't go.
You will be in a video, but it will be them severing your head with a Bowie knife.
And or penis.
Yes. All of these things because Indonesia is a wonderful place. It is currently, I imagine, a horrible, horrible civil war.
Oh, well.
Just so you know.
They make good movies.
Chinese people, as a rule, are racist, super racist against other Asians, but sometimes the racism's wholly justified. As far as I'm concerned, all of Indonesia, fuck those people. Anything beyond the coast, once you start getting in them waters, so yeah, Filipinos, Indonesians.
Get
you'll have
here.
To excuse my co-host.
He's being ultra-Asian racist.
He's being really Chinese right now. So you have to let it go.
Yeah, what do you want to start some?
Those people
Bring
are
it.
Like that.
White devils, fight you all. Let's do some science.
Absolutely.
Jen here with Dave Chacho, special guest Jeremy Bellinger. Here's one of those stories, you know, how jackasses are, why are we studying this? What's that science going to, you know, the Large Hadron Collider? How's it going to put food on the table? Why are we spending billions of dollars on it? And basically the thing is, if you're studying nature, if you're doing science, the gains aren't necessarily like, it's not all just research for a specific cancer drug.
We're talking to you, middle American congressional Tea Party candidates.
By the way, you're talking, that guy that you were talking about is my dad, so.
Okay,
we're talking to you, Jeremy's dad.
Then go ahead
this
and.
This is where your tax dollars are going. To possibly saving the world.
Give him this segment.
Okay.
Because here's the deal. These guys were looking at sea urchins. Actually, what they were doing is they were studying carbonic acid. They're just trying to figure out how that reaction worked, because CO2, when it reacts with water, turns into carbonic acid. And they were looking at some sea urchins who...
They're trying to sap CO2 out of the air.
Because currently, the idea now is we're going to take CO2 and shoot it underground and hope that nothing bad happens.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, so the big picture is...
Carbonating the earth is what we're doing. We're turning into a giant fucking Coca-Cola.
Yeah, well, we're carbonating the atmosphere. There's so much CO2 in the atmosphere from the things we do. And it's, of course, creating a climate catastrophe that's going to kill us all in the next couple minutes.
Yeah.
It seems like when you run out of room in your apartment and you're like, I don't know, put that stuff in the closet, or you know, like put it under the rug. Like scientists are running out of things to just think about. Just like put it somewhere.
This is, yeah, here's, we're going to try to hide it underground.
Here's what the story is.
Literally,
it's, you're going to take all that shit that you would have had to put into a storage space and rent, and it's going to cost, you know, like $150 a month, and we're going to turn it into cash, like junkintogold.com.
CO2 for into gold.
Like all your stupid papers that you just can't get rid of because, like, well, the fourth grade math paper, someday I'm going to have some use for it. Instead of being an asshole pack rat, you're going to send it off and it's going to come back as cash. They're going to send you a check. Like, thank you very much. What they did is they studied sea urchins. And what sea urchins do is they take carbon dioxide and they convert it into calcium carbonate.
Mm-hmm.
Which is, you know, kind of like chalk.
Yeah.
So it's
what it's exactly chalk.
Yeah. And we can use it for a lot of different things. Like we use it for lime agriculturally.
School boards.
Yes. Because we got to put money into schools and
we
like,
use
hey,
it for book learning.
Chalk.
Guys.
That's all you need. What else do you need? What else do you need? Fucking learn
also,
better.
You can write with it and it makes a great antacid.
What they found is there's like a nickel catalyst on a sea urchin. And basically, it catalyzes or it pulls CO2 out of the water. You have carbonic acid in the water, which is not good, and it pulls it out and turns it into calcium carbonate. So it takes something bad and turns it into something useful.
Mm-hmm.
And if we weren't studying sea urchins, maybe it wasn't even that. Maybe they were at a fucking sushi restaurant and they're like, man, you know what would be awesome? If this sea urchin in some way, because he was studying fucking carbonic acid.
I think it was a woman.
And he also happens to be studying... Don't be stupid. Women don't do science.
I believe.
It seems like he...
I'm sorry, Dr. Lydia.
As shocking as this might be, I believe that this was a woman who came up with this idea.
It seems like someone that was really obsessed with sea urchins and then were like, no, don't cut my funding. We can fix things like global warming.
Go on.
there's a thing where they
turn the pollution into rolling.
Okay, not a big idea. Okay, the economy. It'll fix the economy. I don't know. You bring the water out, and then they're you know. Come on, there's something there.
Come on.
This is what we're gonna do with all of our useless nickels when inflation makes them mere scrap metal.
Yeah, it's
so nickel is the metal that sea urchin's skin has in it that catalyzes the chemical reaction that pulls
like,
the CO2.
It's a process that sort of already exists, except currently we have to use this enzyme to, you know, to turn that into calcium carbonate. And it turns out this nickel is like 1,000 times cheaper. Basically, they're just going to put it on top of a smokestack. A bajillion
times more efficient.
Yeah.
At doing the thing that we needed to do.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But now you're going to have like a lot of people that are like, save the sea urchin, guys. How are we going to subject our sea urchins, our beautiful sea urchins?
No,
we're going to put them to work like good, upstanding Americans.
Listen, you're 18 now. You got to start pulling your weight
around.
Our
sea urchins have had enough of a free ride in this country.
You know what?
I want to give them a path to citizenship and jobs.
I saw these sea urchins. They're walking down the street noon.
Yeah.
What do you? You don't have a job? Come on, buddy.
Two things. You're confusing sea urchins with urchins from Little Orphan Annie and from Oliver Twist. Not the same thing.
Oh, no,
and
no,
then
no.
B.
No, you can't have some more, little sea urchin.
And
go
also,
out and earn yourself some more.
It's not like we're jamming sea urchins into tailpipes
and using the sea urchins to catalyze
Come on, man. That's the way I pass emissions in California every 2 years.
They just eat the exhaust and
poop out chalk.
Poop out
chalk? Not at all.
Could you imagine driving down the street and there's just like little parts of chalk coming out? Wonder where Jeremy went. Oh, don't worry. I found his where he goes every day.
Follow the trail.
He's following the chalk.
Police pursuits would be so much easier.
It is time to enter the Borg. Chacho here with Chan and our guest Jeremy Bellinger.
What enter the Borg? Are you confusing?
I'm talking like, about brain computer
a Bruce Lee
interface.
Movie with enter Star Trek.
Enter the Borg. For the people at home, my lips didn't match up with my mouth with what I was saying there.
Yeah, it was pretty amazing. It was a really funny
visual gag.
That's what I do.
Your first podcast? A lot of great visual gags here, guys.
Put on your YouTube page a short video of you saying that with no audio.
And then just mesh it up together.
And then people can listen to that. They can play the video.
I did do one where the theme is that I keep auditioning for things. And so I was like, hey, I'm Jeremy. I would love to go out for any role. Here's my headshot. And then I just stare into camera for like a minute straight.
So anyway, the brain computer interface is something, Chan, we've talked about before. Yes. This is futuristic shit. They have helmets that can read your thoughts and you can steer things with it with
your
brain.
Some pretty
just by
advances.
Thinking of like right, left, up, down.
Like yeah. in the past year there's a person who is missing both arms or one arm, but they have a robotic arm, and with the electrodes, I don't remember if they're like the drilled in your head kind of electrodes or just
no,
like
they're
on
just
your head.
Exterior.
She was able to feed herself, like robot arm, go and pick up a fork, go over and get the food, put it into her mouth, which
Whoa.
Is like really pretty fine motor controls.
Thinking about. Yeah. There's a game, and I don't know how much it costs, but it's probably like $500 or something. And it's a BCI, it's called Brain Computer Interface. It's a BCI helmet, and you can control a little ball that goes around the rim of the helmet with your mind.
No way.
Seems like an awful lot of money to pay to have a little ball go around your
head.
You know what, it seems
awesome.
You know what I also have, guys? Tennis ball. I throw it where I want it to go.
They do have those.
I can do this right here, actually. If I think about it, I can make my arm move in any direction
Whoa!
That I think about.
Bro, you're chipping me out.
Well, check it out. I'm moving this cup.
That's another visual gag.
Nope. Here we go. Nope. Not even
Chad
touching
will
the
put
cup.
A YouTube video.
Not even touching the cup. Look, it's in the
of
air.
This bit.
No,
he is holding it up
air.
With a pen that is not touching you.
They have those, I think they call them Neko Minis. Those
ears,
yeah,
right? Are
the
these
ears.
The ears for in Japan? What kind of crazy, weird creep wears artificial ears that express
you can
your
control?
Feelings?
Oh, do you but control I, the ears going up and down?
Yeah, and
there's
it depends on like if you're in a good meeting.
That is just like darling.
Oh, they're the cutest things. Ever. I guess I was kind of, I don't remember if I was stressed or just totally down that day, but like the ears weren't moving around much because I just tried them on for like a minute because it was at a con.
Oh,
you know, so
you
like,
actually put them
on
your
head.
Yeah,
because like I was walking around, I was like, hey, you want to try these on? And so like, okay. And then I feel weird because like, should I make them move more? I'm like, she's like staring at me. Like at some point I have to take them off. I mean, like I can't just go
can
running around.
Can you hit on a chick?
Like,
can you make one, an ear go like, point at her, point at me?
I would love to see that like the really depressed, the guy that's like going through a breakup and like everyone's super stoked and then he puts them on just like oh. I told
they
you
guys. The Charlie Brown walk away.
That's a sketch idea. Boom, there you go.
Boom.
Next show, put that in there.
We're right.
You can have that. It's free.
Oh, I thanks. I will kind of write and perform it. Sort of.
So anyway, the new thing with brain computer interface is that they're doing a Borg style multiple brain.
Well, let's
function.
Dial it back from fucking collective and let's just say two people piloting a motherfucking spaceship with their brain.
Yes.
All right?
I'm
How
not using
fucking sweet
I'm
is
not,
that?
That is when so I say cool. Borg, I'm not using that in a negative connotation.
Yeah,
I
no,
am ready
no.
to be plugged
all,
in.
Right before this podcast started, Chacho was like throwing all these Borgs.
I'm not racist against Borg, ladies and gentlemen.
He called them metal mines.
I consider them my equals and my brothers, and I...
You call them biggers.
That's just how I learned it when I was growing up, okay? It's not meant anything bad.
In the deep south Andronobonus
cluster. It's
just the word we used. So they have this algorithm where multiple people can steer a spaceship together with their minds. It's basically a video game at this point, but the idea is you could literally plug this into a spaceship and steer it.
And they found it just with two people.
With two people, they found that steering is much more accurate. So,
in case
especially
someone...
in long-term missions, like...
Say you're flying to Venus.
Yeah.
Right.
Like you do.
As you would.
In your spaceship.
Yep.
In your futuristic spaceship.
Nice Sunday afternoon.
You and your hubby... Your beau, your significant other.
So your hubby's like, hey, honey, do you want to go to the farmer's market on Venus? Like, well, that's the far one, but it's the good one, so.
No, I want to go to the Grove. Well, I want to go to the farmer's market. Well, I want to go to the Grove. And the spaceship explodes, as you would expect.
Can we agree that women should not be these?
You are just trampling all over.
Funny how men, when they're steering their spaceship with their mind, never want to ask for directions, and women, when they're steering the spaceship with their mind...
Isn't it funny how men drive spaceships like this? And women be all driving like this.
And for the people at home, we'll put the video of the bit up.
I think you can pretty much imagine.
Chad with a blank face with one eye slightly closed.
Really concentrating, though.
It only works if you have a brain scan of that.
We'll put a YouTube of the MRI of that bit.
I think there's a new night at Nerd Melt where it's just a bunch of brain scan jokes.
It's just a live MRI of the comedians on stage.
Squiggly lines.
And you just watch.
And no one applauds. Dude, they just do
that
this.
Was hilarious.
That's some meta shit, man.
Okay, so I'm going to attack Dum Dums again, Luddites.
Leave me alone.
You know that story where you're walking down the beach and you find a watch and you pick it up and you're like, well, obviously this watch didn't just happen. Somebody must have made it. Aha! There is a Jesus! That's the argument of the watchmaker.
How many sets of footprints walking up towards the gold watch?
Just one. Then two, which is weird because apparently somebody was inside the watch. Came out.
But immaculate.
Jesus set you down to pick up the watch.
But then he left the watch. I don't understand that.
Jesus carry me over there to that watch.
Shut up. Jesus, I'm picking up this watch.
You're always fucking late. Just pick up the watch and use it. For God's sakes, we got to be at the park by 4:30 or my wife's going to kill me. Anyway, what they found is that herds and swarms, flocks of birds.
Schools of fish.
Yeah, all of these things have sort of a pattern to them in a large dynamic when they're moving like that. And so Jeremy Palacci. There's two accent marks, so I don't know if it's J. Ramey or Jeremy Palacci. Palacci.
Sure, we'll take that.
Me
and the other Jeremys of the world.
He's a physicist, so he's looking at these things and saying, if all of these flocks sort of have the same dynamics, then maybe there's something in nature that sort of motivates that.
Actually, he's talking about in physics more than in the biology
swarm. I mean, when I say motivation, I just mean that like there are sort of patterns that that sort of group would fall into.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
And so
it's innate in the structure of the swarm itself rather than in the minds or the brains of the individuals in the swarm.
Not
a sociology thing, a physics thing.
The swarm acts like it was one blob controlled by external physical forces rather than by the brains of a million fish.
Mm-hmm. That's how he was looking at it. What if they were just particles? And so what he did is basically created a swarm of particles. He had these little plastic spheres, just a small microscopic spheres with iron oxide on one side, put it in hydrogen peroxide, and they just kind of went all over the place. Put a blue light on it, and the hematite that was on the sphere oxidized, turned the hydrogen peroxide into hydrogen and oxygen, and what would happen is they would start, the hydrogen peroxide would break apart, more hydrogen peroxide would fall in, and the spheres kind of clump together.
Makes them attract to each other like they were a swarm.
That's why I always wear blue shirts everywhere, guys.
Because
wear blue lights and everything, just so that everyone is attracted to me.
To make you feel more swarm, part of the
swarm.
I want to be swarmed up, guys.
That's,
by the ladies.
Yes, it's basically rave technology. The rave kids have known this for years.
Basically, all swarms are on ecstasy.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And they're listening
Birds,
to house music.
It's just because of the blue lights they're holding up that they are all attracted to each other.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Somebody turns off the little blue LEDs, then they all just scatter.
Whoa, hey.
Wander away.
How do
all right,
we
I'll get out of here. House music sucks.
So what would happen is they would sort of clump together. Then more hydrogen peroxide would flow in and they kind of break apart because, you know, it's back and forth. But when the two spheres came close enough to each other, they attract and they form these clumps
kind of
like crystals. Kind of like a love crystal.
A love crystal.
So these inanimate objects act exactly like a school of fish would.
Or very
in the hydrogen peroxide.
So, you know, like when you're looking at a primordial soup and like, well, fuck it. How could life just come from that? There are all sorts of organizing principles in nature that don't require Jesus to stick his finger in and go, boom! Life!
Yeah.
These things sort of organize themselves just because...
But granted, this is a proof that that's not what's happening here.
No. But I'm going to draw that conclusion. people are more than welcome to email me and tell me...
Jesus' fingers might have been stirring up the
hydrogen peroxide.
What
you're saying is Jesus' finger is just a big blue flashlight, right?
Yes.
Jesus has flashlight fingers. That's well documented.
Mouse. Jesus is dead mouse.
Playing the music of the world.
He's at the Sahara tent.
It was in the Gospel of Mark that they talk about Jesus' rave fingers.
It's, you know, everyone quotes Mark 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. They don't ever say Mark 3:17, which is he has a cool blue light. Follow that shit, dude.
And then Mark 3:18,
and thus Jesus candy flipped his motherfucking balls off.
And it was good.
It's time for a quiz.
It's time for a quiz. We are here with Quizmaster Elizabeth. How you doing, Liz?
I'm good, guys. How are you?
Good. We are going with the new cooperative model. We're going to see how well the three of us do competing against you.
We're going to do this, guys.
We're going to make this happen. Join hands, everybody. Join hands. Let's meld our minds.
Okay, I feel really close to you guys right now.
I feel something, guys. I feel something.
Okay, I'm not touching your hand.
He's got a boner again.
I got it weird again.
Give us question one.
All right, question one. The brain begins to shrink 0.25% in mass every year after what age?
Oh, guys, I think it's between 25 and 32.
That's when you started getting stupider.
Yeah, I think so, because we're all getting dumber here. Guys.
If the answer is younger than my actual age, I want to skip this question.
I think it's in its 20s, and it's surprising. I think it's like your late 20s.
No, I mean, is it going to be something that's
I would say like 35, 40, maybe.
I don't think so. I think it's earlier than that.
Think your body starts to decline in the 30s.
I know that your brain stops fully developing at 25. So it has to be all downhill from... Let's be honest, guys. After college, it's all downhill from there.
So you're suggesting that as soon as it stops growing, it starts diminishing.
We're fucking dying, guys.
You got to give us a range, like within 5.
Yeah, I'll give you within 5.
I like the number 25.
Seems a little young.
It does, but then also
I think 5 is too much. Actually, I'm going to give you within 3 because then you could be like.
That means we're getting close.
Yeah.
I say we split the difference then. Okay.
28.
Do we want to do 28?
28 is the answer.
All right. The answer is actually 30. So congratulations, guys.
Shoot.
We got it.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Boom.
Look at me, Mom.
Ooh.
We did
also, my brain has been deteriorating for a number of years now, and I feel very, very insecure.
Yeah, one more year. One more year, guys, and then I'm going to slowly die.
At least that portion of our brain has not deteriorated yet.
the portion of the brain that
keeps track of deteriorating brains.
The portion that searches out pornography is still
alive and well. It's getting better and better.
Growing every year.
That one is freakishly inflamed.
Question two.
All right. For this question, I kind of feel like I should give you guys a time limit.
Oh,
but
okay.
We'll see after that.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll set the clock, and as soon as you're done answering, we'll start it.
The second question is, how many ribs do you have in the human body?
How many ribs?
Oh, well, females have one less, right? Because of Adam.
Adam would have one less because of Eve.
Yeah, that's what I said, guys. Cher has one less than all of us.
I'm trying to feel, but I'm too fat.
I'm going to say it's like around
37.
We've got 10 seconds,
five,
you guys.
Six.
Oh, you skinny motherfucker.
Within three.
I'm going to say
37.
How many?
12?
Oh, it's got to, it should be even.
On one side?
12.
24.
Yeah, 12 on one side, so 24.
24.
So the answer, our answer is 24.
And you are correct.
Whoa!
It finally paid off to be gaunt.
Fuck you. You live in Hollywood. It pays to be gaunt every day.
Not for men.
Oh. No, because I am chubby, and that has not helped me one goddamn
bit. It doesn't pay off to be fat or thin or
nothing pays off in Hollywood, guys.
Okay, fair enough. If you're not Johnny Depp, it does not pay. It doesn't pay to not be Johnny Depp.
Yep, double negatives like a motherfucker.
He's a very small man.
I specifically requested to be Johnny Depp and for this very reason.
Damn you, God!
Next question.
All right, this one's multiple choice.
Ooh.
What is the scientific term for those muscle contractions you feel before you go to sleep? Is it A, supination, B, dystonia, or C, hypnic myoclonia?
Well, so supination is the way a hand moves, so it can't be that. Supination and pronation is the way a hand moves in anatomy, so that's wrong.
Dystonia sounds like it's something that could be bad.
Sounds like a bad place to go. I think
what?
The third one.
I think it's the third one because it sounds the craziest, which is kind of like the way.
What was the third one again?
Body.
Hypnic myoclonia.
I think that myoclonia has something to do with muscles. So, yeah, let's say C.
Yeah, I think that one sounds pretty
We say
right.
C.
And the answer is C.
Yeah. Oh,
this commutative mind.
I wish I did this good in college.
Well, if you had two of us sitting by you, you probably would have been.
Hi, Mr. Wilson. Can I take this question?
This counts as college credit, actually.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you can go back and
great, guys.
Put this on your.
I'm going to combine it with my UCB.
I might have to want it on your resume. I might have to pass fail this one, to be honest.
In fact, put this on the back of your headshot in their experience.
Number four.
All right, this is another multiple choice. Which of these is not a system that eliminates waste in the body? Is it A, the urinary system, B, the respiratory system, C, the reproductive system, or D, the lymphatic system?
So I'm going to say this right now. Most people would say that anything coming out of me in the reproductive sense is trash.
But we're not all your mother. Oh.
Hello.
It's got to be reproductive because
you
don't want to
waste. You put in oxygen and spit out carbon dioxide.
Yeah,
it's a waste product. Yeah.
Urinary, obviously. I mean, it tastes wonderful, but you're supposed to get rid of it. And the
supposed
other
to
the lymph system.
The lymph system. I believe it. Cleans.
Oh yeah, it gets rid of like bacteria, viruses, or something.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah, but I don't know how it expels.
I don't know how it gets rid of them through the skin, right?
It gets rid of them somehow because when they plump up, that's when they're not working right.
Okay,
is that the system
you're gonna say like, well, the lymph nodes? That's like in your ankles, right?
Yeah, right.
Are the lymph nodes the ones that send your viruses to a different dimension?
Yeah, what it is.
All right.
The negative zone is where they go.
So we're going to say C.
Oh, it's either this communal consciousness or my level of difficulty for these questions, but you're correct.
Boom, 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 yeah. boom.
Yes.
Nailing it. What's number five?
Which hemisphere of the brain has more neurons?
I think here's what I would guess, guys. I think it would be the right because your heart's on your left, maybe.
I would say it'd be on your left since most people are right-handed.
Okay.
The left side is the one with all the calculating and
reason,
math.
Right?
Yeah.
And you're right. No.
The right side's the artistic.
The right is the board brain.
Like, hey, man,
let's
right smoke
is the
some
Picasso
weed.
Brain. Yes. Yeah. The weed side of your brain.
Guys.
The left is the Einstein, the right is Picasso. Einstein clearly smarter.
And Picasso.
So we're going to go Einstein here?
I would say left.
I'm still going with left because of the hand thing.
Yeah, let's all go left then.
For different reasons, we're going to go say left.
All different reasons.
We say left.
Chupacabra, the left hemisphere of the brain has 186 million more neurons than the right.
Boom. We killed it.
Guys, we were successful.
We're the best.
We crushed.
Cool. Thank you, Quizmaster Liz.
But it's not over.
We have five
more questions coming up next episode. Mm-hmm.
So we could lose this all.
So
we could tank every single one of them.
No.
She could get angry that we got them all right and just whip out some shit like, what is the chemical formula for hydroglucosone?
CG2? I don't know.
CH6. H5! You lose!
It's a covalent bond, you idiot.
Oh, my ionic bonds are so... Quizmaster Liz, where can they find you online?
You can find me at 24 Starfleet on Twitter and on Facebook at Chupa Mother Flipping Cabra.
Awesome.
All right. See you later.
So a few weeks ago, we talked about the Persian space monkey with Jesse Thorne.
That's racist.
It's just a description.
It's serious. Well, actually, people were giving John McCain shit for saying... He tweeted something like, Ahmadinejad wants to go up into space, huh? Didn't they already send a monkey up into space? And then people started flipping out like, excuse me, people of color have been called monkeys in this country for far too long.
That's not people of color, that's black people.
An Iranian is not a black person, so calm the fuck down. Also,
probably some Iranians have been
funny,
called monkeys before.
But it's not a thing.
I've been called a monkey before.
It's not a thing.
By my dad.
Not every monkey.
Guys, have you seen the zoo? It is super racist.
Oh,
there are monkeys
God.
Behind.
There's so many blacks all over the place.
They are behind bars, apparently. Oh. I didn't see any of them there. I just saw a bunch of little weird creatures with long arms and they could climb. But racism
so
everywhere.
So insensitive that they exist. Terrible. But we are talking about an actual monkey in actual Iran that was supposedly sent up into a spaceship. And the monkey that came back down apparently was a completely different monkey than the one that went up.
What?
Or something.
Oh, so, oh,
they,
I
so they,
I hung,
they paraded this monkey around before the launch in front of the Iranian TV station, and it had a little monkey tuxedo on. It was
well dressed to go up in space.
Yeah,
yeah.
And it,
I'm really
a
frankly
lot of
disappointed in NASA that they don't send up our astronauts in tuxedos.
Dude, remember, that monkey that we sent up, man.
So shabbily
dressed.
Yeah.
Sloppy.
Shoes untied.
No top hat or anything.
Yeah.
Really? What are aliens going to think when they see us up there?
He couldn't tap dance for anything.
So anyway, the monkey that... So they had the monkey before the launch, and then they said, we successfully launched the monkey into space, and he came home, and he's okay, and they paraded another monkey out.
Mr. Professor, that monkey looks like a hedgehog.
Shut up. It is a monkey.
Oh. So.
It's clearly a different monkey. It's got like a big mole over his eye and he's like a different coloration and just his hair is like different looking.
And they only have so many monkeys in Iran, right? So
yeah.
Like he got a perm up there. Come on. The Iranians know that you got to go into space looking good.
Yeah.
You can't come down looking like an asshole.
No, you got to.
Of course.
You got to fix your look up.
Put a beauty mark on
there.
Maybe
they
get
they
a
have
tan.
Like a,
it's basically the actress salon from the artist. You know, they had to put a beauty mark to, you know, now you're a star. You have the mark.
This is very well what could have happened.
Iranians aren't just about science. They're about science
and style. And poorly covered conspiracies. Remember when they like photoshopped those extra rockets? I think it was like three or four years ago. They had rockets. They had like a official press photo. And it was like of this thing that shoots rockets out.
Missiles.
And they added like four of them. And people looked at them. And then like 4 hours later, people were like, this is a bad Photoshop. And they like showed it. And then
this
Iran was
just
like,
just drawn
right.
with the pencil tool in the background.
Is that your grandmother from your summer vacation in that picture?
Yeah. But
why does it say boom and scrawled in the background?
But here's the thing. Just like park two next to each other. Like they just put like instead of one, they put three. So just park one more next to it. It looks way more impressive.
Unless they only have the one. They're probably barely above North Korea in terms of space technology, it sounds like.
They were where we were when...
We don't really know where they are in the space technology. Yeah, at best, they were where we were in the 60s.
50 years ago, right?
Yeah, 50s, 60s. But they might not even be to that point. Because it seems
they bring
a little
back.
Fishy. Although Ahmadinejad, who his term is over this year, volunteered.
Four more years.
You're not going to get it.
I'm going to go vote for him.
It's time for change. It's time for hope. He volunteered.
Well, let's not be real big on the hope part. Let's not be so big on the change either. Like that guy. Give me another one of those.
Yeah.
That's pretty much what the mullahs are saying.
Ayatollah Khomeini?
I think that guy's dead.
Yeah, Ayatollah Khomeini died, but there's a new guy who's, I think it's Ayatollah Khomeini or Khomeini.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
Like
so they have,
exactly
four
the same.
They have four names that they keep recycling and two monkeys.
That's our show.
And that's our show. Thank you very much to our very special guest, Mr. Jeremy Bellinger. Yeah!
Thank you very much, guys.
Where can they find you if they're looking for you?
Yeah, I'm on Twitter at Jeremy Bellinger. And then I'm also on YouTube at youtube.com/Mr. Jeremy Bellinger.
More formal.
And you perform and write at IO West in Hollywood, California.
Yes, as part of the sketch group, The Mutiny.
You go monthly or?
Monthly. Yeah, we have a show.
Second Sundays?
Second Sunday of the month, or third. I think third Sunday of the month, 7:30. We're paired up with Brute Squad, 7:30. And our next show is February 17th. So come out and see us.
Yeah. If you're in Los Angeles
visiting,
or if you live here like a weirdo.
Flying from Guam.
Guam.
We'd like to see you.
More Guam people. Guamites. Guamies?
Guamies.
They call them Guamies.
It's offensive.
I'm sure it is. You can find us at sciencejerks.com or thesciencejerks.com. Go ahead and email us, Chan at
sciencejerks. Chacho at sciencejerks. At the Science Jerks on Twitter.
Yep.
Facebook/the
We post links and such, and we make the funnies when we're not sending out podcasts. So check it out. You'll like it. Trust me.
Even if you don't trust him,
do it anyway.
Do it.
It's like a trust fall exercise in an improv class. Just do it, man. Don't be a dick. The teacher said just fucking fall backwards. We're going to catch you. That's how this works.
And then no one catches you.
No one catches
that's
you because that's how podcasts work.
Received my brain damage and started podcasting.
Where you fit right in.
I'm at Dave Chacho.
I'm at 999 RPMs.
And we'll be back with more from Jeremy Bellinger in just a few short days. Hey man, what if we're all just steering this spaceship called Earth together, man?
Yeah, there we go.
It's like due course. It's like straight as she goes.
You can't hear this right now, but I am thinking daggers into your heart.